Hello and welcome to the International Daily Roundup with People's Dispatch, where we bring you some of the top stories from across the globe. Let's take a look at today's headlines. Haitian police state alleged assassins of Jovenel Moïse have been killed in a gun battle. Israeli forces demolish Palestinian Bedouin homes in the West Bank. Lawmakers accuse US military of underreporting overseas civilian casualties. Ex-IMF official appointed as governor of the Central Bank of the Democratic Republic of Congo. Haitian officials have stated that four alleged suspects in the assassination of Jovenel Moïse have been killed. Police Chief Leon Charles announced late on July 7th that mercenaries had been killed in a gun battle. Two others have reportedly been captured. Charles made the announcement less than a day after Haiti's de facto President Moïse was killed in his home. Heavy gunfire could be heard in the Perilin 5 district of Port-au-Prince early morning on Wednesday. While only a few details have been provided, the unidentified attacker spoke English or Spanish, according to a statement released by the Prime Minister. They were also heavily armed and trained. Meanwhile, interim Prime Minister Claude Joseph has taken over as the acting head of state. This is despite the fact that less than a day before his death, Jovenel Moïse had appointed Ariel Henry as a new Prime Minister. Joseph has also imposed a countrywide state of siege for 15 days. As per the country's 1987 constitution, only the parliament has the authority to do so. However, Haiti has been without a parliament after the body was dissolved in 2020. The state of siege will now authorize police and security forces to enter homes. Meetings meant to excite or prepare for disorder have been prohibited. As reports by Haiti Libre, civilian courts will also be replaced by military courts. Security forces are now authorized to take all general measures that permit the arrest of the assassins. Meanwhile, Claude Joseph has held meetings with U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken and the core group. A private meeting of the UN Security Council was also held on July 8. Israeli forces demolished homes of the Palestinian Bedouin community of Hamza al-Baqai in the occupied West Bank on July 7. As per the Norwegian Refugee Council, 8 residential shelters, 4 livelihood structures, water tanks and agricultural equipment were destroyed. Around 70 Palestinians, including 35 children, have now lost their homes. This is the 7th time that the hamlet has been demolished since November 2020. At that time, Israel destroyed 83 structures in what is considered the largest single demolition incident in recent years. The Hamza community is set in the path of 2 illegal Israeli settlements, Bekaut and Roe. The hamlet is located in Area C of the Jordan Valley, which is placed under Israeli military control. The area has been designated as a firing zone for military training. 6,200 people or 38 Palestinian Bedouin communities are located in this zone. Access to water, sanitation, electricity and education is extremely limited. Israeli authorities have demolished or seized at least 421 Palestinian structures in the West Bank in 2021. The UNOCHA has noted a 50% increase in the number of people displaced as compared to 2020. Meanwhile, Palestinians in the village of Bieta have continued the night confusion activities. This form of protest, which includes lighting fires and flashing lights, began after an illegal Israeli outpost was set up on the Jabal Sabeh mountain. Starting May, protests spread in the area and were met with brutal repression. At least 5 Palestinians were killed and over 300 were injured. The Israeli military has now evacuated the settlement, claiming that the land is state-owned. However, instead of returning it to the Palestinians, it is now being turned into a military base and a religious school. Several civil society groups and lawmakers have accused the US military of underreporting civilian killings overseas. A Department of Defense report released in June states that the US was responsible for unintentionally killing 23 civilians. Another 10 had been injured. These figures were from overseas military operations in Iraq, Afghanistan, Somalia, Yemen, and Nigeria in 2020. The numbers reported in the 2020 report are significantly lower than the 132 civilian killings recorded in 2019. Meanwhile, these figures are significantly lower than the casualties reported by other sources. According to monitoring group Air Wars, at least 102 civilians were killed in US operations last year. The United Nations Assistance Mission in Afghanistan reported the killings of at least 89 civilians. Another 31 were injured. Meanwhile, official records show only 20 casualties. Moreover, the US Congress had approved a compensation of $3 million for affected families. The Department of Defense report shows that not a single family has been compensated. In a letter made public this week, two lawmakers, Elizabeth Warren and Ro Khanna, have asked defense officials to review the discrepancies. According to the US government, 733 civilians have been killed and 335 have been injured in military operations since 2017. However, other sources, including the UN, place the number of casualties much higher. And for a final story, we go to the Democratic Republic of Congo. President Felix Tshisekedi has appointed Malango Kabedi Mbui to serve as governor of the central bank. She was previously an International Monetary Fund official and worked in other African countries, including Sierra Leone and Burkina Faso. She will be the first woman appointed to this post in the country. Kabedi Mbui will now oversee a three-year, $1.5 billion loan deal between the IMF and the DRC. Here is Kambale Musawili to talk about the concerns surrounding her appointment.
I mean, the Bretton Woods institutions in the DRC have a fascinating and devastating record. I remember in the 1980s, in the early 1980s, I'll say 1981, the IMF themselves actually audited the finance that were giving the president at the time. The president at the time was Mobutu. In their own audit, they discovered that the money that was being given in the to the country was being embezzled. Surprisingly, the year after, they continued to provide more and more funds to Mobutu. We can see with the structural adjustment program where they forced the Congolese states, back then Zaire, to pretty much privatize many of its sector to move money away from education, public education, and focus more on mining and so on, how it had a devastating impact on the in the country. Now, by the end of the 1980s, we saw the deterioration, a complete deterioration of the Zairean economy back then. And many African countries suffered from that. The same thing we continue to see in Congo, right in the 2000s, right during the war. You know, we had Laurent Kabila who took power, then later Joseph Kabila after the death of Laurent Kabila in 2001. We continue to see that the World Bank funds project in DRC while they see questions of corruption. There is another element that's also fascinating about these two institutions from the Bretton Woods, World Bank and IMF. Many people do not know that in the early 2000s, that the World Bank and IMF, they wrote the forestry laws of the Congo. They wrote the mining laws of the Congo, pretty much determining how mining will be done. Some of the laws pretty much gave control of the land to mining companies from the surface all the way to the magma for the exploitation. We had people such as a member of parliament called Lutundula who fought it. There were many others who mobilized to challenge some of the policies. We're still fighting to transform all of those things, but it's still ongoing. Now to modern day, we are now in the past 2 to 3 years, we've seen the World Bank literally giving away money that they know that's going to be misused. The World Bank knows that the money is being misused. So it's quite surprising that they continue to give money to the DRC. And what does that actually say? I mean, the history of the World Bank and IMF, as I just listed in the past few years, has been that they provide funds to African leaders who seem to be on the side of Washington, even with the human rights abuses and corruption and any other issues that they may have, they continue to provide them with funds.
And that is all we have for this episode of the International Daily Roundup. For more such stories and videos, visit our website, peoplesdispatch.org, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and visit us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Thank you for watching.